Anybody ever play bumper cars? You guys are really, are you, everybody all right? Did everybody like, did like the time change happen for a lot of you late or something? Like, cause I'm just like, wow, man, it's so good to be with you. And the robins, they said they're going south for another couple of days, but they'll be back. The geese, they're kind of flying back and forth. They don't know what to do. They go south, go north, go south, go north. And I'm glad you decided to stay. Glad to have you here. Glad you can make it, you know. How many normally go to the 9 o'clock service? I know what you did today. So, wow. Anybody want to talk? Because I really don't have anything to say today. You know what I like about pastors? That they shouldn't chew gum in church. And then watch this. And they stick them underneath where no one will ever find their gum. Aren't you glad that God sees us for who we are, not how we act? That's a good word right there. So, well, hey, we're glad that you guys are here. We have a special guest with us that is going to be here tonight with us, Stacy Campbell. Stacy, would you stand real quick? This is Stacy Campbell. And I love this lady and her husband. And we met without us knowing that we met at a thing called Firestorm, which anytime you meet somebody in a firestorm, you know it's going to be a good thing, you know? And down at the Life Center in Harrisburg, New York, and she just, the first Harrisburg, New York, no, you guys don't understand. You guys don't understand. Pennsylvania, New York has become one. And I'm hoping that we take on more of their DNA than us. That was not a mistake, because we really feel like with some of the words that have been spoken over the Northeast, that what the Lord's doing in our region is significant, that there won't be any divides. And we really believe that to be true. I think we're losing the family divisions. I think we're losing the city, town, village divisions. I think we're losing the county divisions, but here's the big deal, is I think we're losing the spiritual divisions. I think that the things that used to divide us no longer have a voice in us. And that's really, really good news, where we can actually like each other just because. There is one criteria. You have to be a Buffalo Bills fan. We can get unity another way. Don't make me do this, but we could hate Dallas fans. But as Jane Rundle always says, that will never do. So, you know, can't we just get along and sing Kumbaya right now? Everybody just grab each other's hands. Let's just sing Kumbaya right now. Well, man, we're glad you're here today. And Tuesday night, we're doing something crazy. I'm getting to know the family at Journey on Tuesday night. We're going to have a dinner here at 6 o'clock. And literally, we are making some major, major announcements. This is my daughter, Calissa. That's one of the major announcements. Hi, Calissa. everybody, we live in such a good country. You know, like last night, we did her taxes. And she's getting $44 back. Who would have known? You know, we were like figuring, let's see, $46,000 for insurance and you're getting, or not insurance, $46,000 for tuition and you're getting $44 back. Yes, that's a win. I mean, I don't care who you are. So, I mean, that's almost a tank of gas. I know. So, what was I saying? Oh, so Tuesday night, getting to know the family at Journey and the team members and stuff. We're going to have a dinner at 6. We're going to have amazing stuff for the kids. So if you want to show up Tuesday night, meet some folks, and get to meet some of the team, and be with us for some major, I mean, we've got some sick, ridiculous, major announcements that we'd like to share with you. And I'm not going to tell you today because I want you to come out Tuesday night. So Tuesday night, 6 o'clock dinner, we're going to do some of that. Then we're going to do some questions and answer, give you some updates on what your giving into benevolence is providing for a lot of amazing people, and then some of the facilities updates and some of those things we've got going on too. So we want to invite you for that. And then, our mountain update. Our mountain update, if you don't know what that is, we're going to do it Tuesday night. It's this. We believe that church, that the kingdom, that the people of God should actually change the world. We have this crazy idea. No matter what your world is, no matter what network you're in, no matter what place of influence you have, we believe that we should be atmosphere changers and that we should actually impact the people around us rather than situations and people impacting us. We actually impact them. Does that make sense? And so with that, probably 15 to 20 different people in our church, in our community here at Journey, we're going to talk about a little bit about their stories of how they are changing their worlds locally, in the state, in the region, nationally, and even internationally, because really our assignment is to disciple nations, not just a single person. But it takes a people group, a nation, a demographic of people to do that. And I'm so stoked to hear all the reports of what's going on with the people that you're sitting next to right here, that God is just using the body of Christ to impact the world in a way that, man, I just haven't seen happen like he's doing it now. There's apostles all around you. There's prophets all around you. There's teachers, evangelists. What's the other one? Pastors. Yes, that's right. Can't forget us. All around you that are doing great works of just loving people, loving God, watching the way that people love people with integrity in such a beautiful way that situations, those fearful things, those challenges, places where people have been robbed or stolen from, relationships that have been stolen from, that God is not only restoring them and not just having them survive, but they're literally thriving in our midst. It's just such good news. How many know that it's good news that actually is good news? And that Jesus came to give us good news. For too long, we have been talking about for too long. What has gone on in the church for too long is this. Is that you and I have had our conscience affected by this powerful thing called religion. And religion is powerful, and religion, because it's powerful, has had the ability to be dangerous. And because religion has truth in it, a lot of times you're not able to see the lie hidden in the truth. Is that making sense? So a lot of times in the name of God, we have done Satan's work. And so I want to say, you know what, it's okay. And I'm going to give you the end of the game. We win because he already won. And here's really good news for all of you. We can't mess it up. You can't mess it up. Because let me just say something. All the people in the kingdom and in Christianity and in the name of God have been really trying to mess it up for a long time. But Jesus is building his church. He is building his church. And it's his church. And ultimately, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It is going to happen. And in case you didn't know, all of you who are bowing your knees to Jesus right now, you are preempting something that's going to happen for everyone, including Satan and all of his angels, his fallen angels, is that every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that which is your confession right now. So it's not a matter of whether people are going to confess that Jesus is Lord. It's a matter of when they confess him, and the benefit of when they confess him is ignited by choosing him today, because today is the day of salvation. You don't wait till tomorrow. You're not promised tomorrow. You're not promised next. It's like, hey, you're there, you're real, I confess you now, and my heart is aligned with you. Kind of like what we talked about last week. Because he's resurrected, he's alive, he's not dead. Haven't you seen the movie God's Not Dead 2? No? You know why you haven't seen it, Jane? Oh, is it out? Oh, crap, I was going to say that. You know, hey, can you get rid of crap, by the way? I don't want to say Delete that. If you're live streaming, I did not say crap. I said clap. It was clap that I said. So, your conscience, whether you know it or not, determines your religious realities, whether they reflect reality or not. Your conscience is what drives your behavior. And the problem is that your conscience can be influenced by truth, or your conscience can be influenced by lies. Your conscience can be influenced by other people's words over you. Your conscience can be influenced by other people's behavior towards you. And then all of a sudden, your conscience, under the influence of whatever spirit it's being influenced by, how many know if you're not being influenced by Holy Spirit, you're being influenced by some other spirit? There's like, and so what happens is, in this thing of the temple model, which we've been talking about, we understand that whoever controls your conscience ultimately will control your behavior. I'd like to say to you that if your identity controls your conscience, then your identity will control your behavior. If you know who you are, then you will act as you know who you are. Let me put it another way. If people treat people like animals long enough, they will act like animals. Yes? But you treat your daughter like she's a princess, she will act like a princess. Because see, here's the deal. When a person starts to believe that they are a king, when a person starts to believe that they are a priest, when a person starts to believe that they are a son, when a person starts to believe that they're a daughter and they're no longer slaves and to fear and that they're no longer orphans, then all of a sudden they step out of what used to be their behavior and they step into their identity, and their conscience has to come into alignment with their identity, and they begin to act in a way that aligns with who they are. Does that make sense? So if we can get people, and this is where the church is really messed up, we've been so focused on people's behaviors that we've lacked the focus of their identity. And if we can get people to understand really that you are an amazing daughter of God, if you can begin to look at people and see them the way that God the Father sees them, and you begin to declare over people what he would declare over people, and you begin to think about people the way that he thinks about people, you're going to be able to be a world changer by being a world shaper, by what you declare over people prophetically over their life, that you can draw out the very gold that God placed inside of them. Because when God made you and you and you and you, he did not make any mistakes. And mistakes does not dictate your identity. That makes sense? But the temple model has been so consumed with our behavior. The temple model, we've been really more concerned about building great places than we have been about building great people. The difference today is God's concerned not about the dirt that you stand on, but he's concerned about the one on your right and the one on your left. Oh, and he's concerned about the one who's right here. It's a big deal. You now are the place where Holy Spirit dwells. Yes? See, I think that was way better news than what you just reacted to. God has decided to come live in you. Now, for some of you, they may not be good news because, oh my God, he sees everything now. Yeah, he does. But here's the good news about that. He saw everything before he ever moved in, and he still moved in. And guess what? You can't evict him, you can't evict him. Because greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Ah, though you're faithless, he's faithful. Though you may give up on him, he will never give up on you. Though you may walk away from him, he will never leave you or forsake you. I'm really glad that I'm depending on his faithfulness rather than mine. Yes? Okay, listen, if you don't talk, I'm not talking anymore. Oh, let's go home. That might really be a great idea. Who's inviting the pastor over for lunch today? I see that hand. Okay. Thanks, Travis. Rest of your jerks, man. I'm just kidding. Don't listen to those declarations. Because these temple places, don't hear me wrong, I'm not just talking about church or the Jewish temple. I'm talking about Islam. I'm talking about the Buddhist. I'm talking about, go down the list. Any place that has sacred places, they always have sacred texts. And they always have sacred men. And by the way, they're always men. And they always have sincere followers, amazing followers. But sometimes the followers are superstitious. Sometimes the followers are scared followers. You know why they're scared followers? Because religion likes to use fear to manipulate people. The thing that has really bothered me, though, is that not only are they scared followers, but we've left a lot of scarred followers. There's been a lot of damage in the name of God. There's been a lot of damage in the name of Jesus. There's been a lot of, because of some things that we have misunderstood, some things that we have represented him wrong in, some things that we haven't understood completely, so we've made decisions based upon our own wisdom rather than on the wisdom of God. We've complicated something, and we've asked the question, I've been asking this question for a while, how did we get here? How did we get to this place from what was his original intent for his church? How do we get to a place where we have thousands of denominations now? Us against them, the elite against the non-elite. I don't know. But when you look at history, you can see a lot of where we came from, which will help us determine and a trajectory of where we want to go in the future. How many want to move towards him, not away from him? So let's do a little history lesson today if we can. The reason I want to start here is that the temple model that was in the earth for so long, Jesus showed up and he did something brand new. We had hundreds of commandments, hundreds of do's and don'ts, the law. We had a system, a temple model that said, you got to do this, 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 and this, and this in order to please God. And Jesus came and he said, listen, I want to bring a new covenant, a new contract. I want to replace animal sacrifice with self-sacrifice. I want to take and replace all of these laws with one new commandment. One new commandment. This is my commandment, that you love one another. That when you forget everything else, when you can't remember the other 10 commandments, when you can't remember the 630-some commandments, when you can't remember all the to-dos and you just don't feel like you qualify and you just don't feel like you can be good enough, remember this. Just remember this. Let this be your filter. What does love demand? What is love speaking to your heart? How should you interpret this scripture? How should you interpret that expression? How should you interpret their behavior towards you? And Jesus said, do this. Love one another the way that I've loved you. Then he goes on, he says, why? Because I want to start something new. I want a new ethic. I want you to live your life by this new concept. I want you to make all your decisions. I want a people that are known by something, and it's not going to be because of how many scriptures you know. It's not going to be how many prayers you've prayed. It's not going to be how many times you went to church or how much you give to God. It's going to be based upon this one thing and this one thing alone. How do you love? Do you love people with integrity? Do you love people with everything that's within you? Are you willing to lay down your own life? Do you consider others more than you do yourself? They're going to know that you're mine by how you love. Guys, where did we go wrong? Where did we make this so complicated? Where did we make it more about you get a star if you memorize a scripture rather than if you're kind to somebody today? I remember getting all the stars. In children's church, I love the stars. I live for the stars. And I played draw swords. I knew I could beat you. I know where that scripture is. I can beat you. I got the mindset that I could beat you with this all the time. Oh, I got to sit down. I think I need some oxygen. Somebody, please. And listen, I am sorry to you. Because I've done that, my dad's done that, my grandfathers have done that. I've learned from generations how to beat people over the head with a precious love letters from my God. And I've known how to point things. I can point things out. I know every light bulb that's out in your house. I can find everything. I've become amazing at seeing what's wrong. Because I've learned from the best. And the church has become brilliant at finding what's wrong with people instead of finding what's right with them. And for that, I'm sorry that you got wounded. I'm sorry that you got scarred. But here's the good news today. Our Father is not like that. In fact, when he looks at you, he says, oh, did I tell you that I forgave that moment that you put it into my son and into the blood, that my son's blood covered it? And you know what I did? I threw it into a sea of forgetfulness on purpose. He's not forgetful. He's not like he doesn't have Alzheimer's. Nothing going on there like that. He chooses when he forgives to say, "I'm done with that." Listen, there's no need to discuss it anymore. You're free. You're free. That's good news. You're free. Do you realize you're free? You're free from every word that's been spoken evil over your life. You're free from every abusive word that's been spoken over your life. Everything you've thought of God that was inappropriate is broken over your life. Only the goodness of God, the gentleness of God, the kindness of God has a place to reside in you where it has the ability to change the way that you think about him, about you, and about other people. It is the love of God that is the priority of God. I believe that to be true. In fact, there was a whole movement that was built that people gave their lives for it. That's how Jesus changed and made this brand new thing, this brand new creation that's you and me. Paul said this to the Galatians. He said, Paul, who was killing Christians and who was just the tormentor of the early church, who persecuted Jesus Christ in the ways that I just talked about, but he literally did it. It was literally, he would massacre people just because they believed in Jesus, because they behaved like Jesus, because they loved like Jesus, because they were willing to die for Jesus. Paul said this later on when he had his encounter with Jesus. He said, the only thing that counts, can you say that with me? The only thing that counts. Wait, have you read the 66 books in the Bible? This is Paul. You want to argue with Paul? You want to argue with Holy Spirit? You go right ahead. I'm not up for it. Paul says this, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through what? Well, isn't faith, is what pleases God. It's impossible to please God without faith. Well, I'd like to propose to you that faith doesn't have the ability to work without love. Faith without works is dead, and faith works through love. And anything that's not motivated by love is nothing but noise. Yes? Oh, but I have this great faith. I don't care if you don't have love. Don't show me your faith. Your faith means nothing. It is. You interpret that. Then Paul said to the Corinthians, who were all going to their temples. The Jewish Christians, they'd go to their temple to worship God, to get right with God. I got a problem with God. I got to go to the temple. Get to the temple. I got to get to the temple. I got to get to the temple. I love the temple. We built a temple. We're all gathered here in this temple. But you are the temples. And he told these pagans who were just becoming Christians, he told these pagans who kept running to all their temples with all their gods, who were just trying to work out their Christianity, like they didn't know what to do. Can I tell you something? The pagans didn't have a Bible. The Jewish, they had the Old Testament. They didn't have the New Testament because there wasn't any New Testament because they were living the New Testament. They were being written about the New Testament while they were doing the New Testament. It's crazy. How do we survive without the sacred text? That's my thoughts, exactly. But Paul said this. He said, listen, you're the temples of the Holy Spirit. Wait a minute, Paul. Okay, that's enough. The Holy Spirit resides in the temple. Holy Spirit resides in the temple. He's saying, no, you guys don't understand. You are the temple. Your body is now the place. Listen to this, deep. This is where God resides. He lives inside of you. That's why everybody should go to Journey Fitness. You can get your temple in shape. I'm not kidding about that a whole lot. Let me just say this, right? Let me just say this. There's a revival coming that your body's going to have to be able to endure. And if you don't eat right, if you don't sleep right, and if you don't treat yourself, if you don't exercise, if you don't, listen, body, soul, and spirit, this little sidetrack, free today. Body, soul, and spirit, getting, because there's, listen, to live a sustainable life in the revival that God wants to do in the earth, it's going to require, it's going to be taxing all of that on your body, on your soul, and on your spirit. But not a person who is in health in all three ways is going to thrive during that time. You don't want to be going to sleep while the revival's going on. Straight up, man. Your body is the temple. Take care of it. Take care of yourself. Take care of his home. Does that make sense? You should sleep at night. You really should. You shouldn't listen. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray against every single person here who's being tormented with night dreams or visions or nightmares, whatever those things are that are just owning them where their minds can't go to sleep. God, I pray for rest over your people, that your peace would be over your people, that Father, where there's worry and where there's fear, where there's anxiety, where there's stress, God, I pray that all decreases as you increase and the peace of heaven comes on each one. God, hey, listen, your dad's got you. He has you. Don't believe that lie that God's in control. Listen, God is all powerful and he wants to co-labor with you, but don't rest in the fact, well, whatever happens to me is God's. It's not. There's a lot of things that are happening to you that God hasn't intended to happen to you. Don't let the enemy steal from you any longer. Don't let him take one more thing, not one thing of death, none of that stuff. God is all powerful and God is for you, but understand this, there's a co-laboring effort. He says, listen to me, this is what I'm inviting you into, now move into it. But it's your will, it's your choice. Okay, side note, just had to give that to you. I don't know. See, what Paul experienced, what Jesus delivered to us, we started off really, really good. In fact, the pagans would look at us and they'd go, what's wrong with these people, these Jesus people, what's wrong with them? They take care of their own orphans. They take care of their own widows. But what really weirds us out is they're taking care of ours too. The Romans would throw young girls away and the Christians would take them in. The different pagan cultures would had no use for certain, whether it be women or whether it be, and they'd throw them away, and the Christian culture would say, come on. And the Christian culture would empower women, and it would empower children, and it would protect women, and it would protect children. And men were actually men. But they didn't just talk about it, but they would lay down their lives for it. And not just for themselves. But here's the thing that rocked the pagans. That should be a song right there. Rock the pagans. Maybe a band. We should call a band Rock the Pagans. Anyways, okay. So if you're new here, I apologize. If you think that I am weird, your thoughts are absolutely correct. Really, 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 really. Every bad thing you've ever heard about me, I got 100 times more bad things I can tell you about me. Oh. I heard the bubbles burst. Can I just tell you something? Listen. At some point, we got to get over making people and making idols. Where the only time you hear from God is when they speak. You're all meant to have relationship with your Father every minute of every day. If there's anything good in me, it's only him. But with that said, I am a son. I'm way better than you think. And so are you. But it's because of his grace and because of his mercy and because of his love and because of his kindness and because of his patience with me that I'm actually beginning to look like him. And it's the same with you, and it's the same like with them, and we're all on different journeys at different timetables. Let's start being okay where people are at in their journey and not think just because you're a little bit further down the road that makes you more spiritual than the one who's still back there a little ways, because Jesus said, I went all the way back and became like them and the least of them, and I'm the servant of the least of them. And if you do this unto the least of these, my brother, you have done it unto me. Want to love Jesus? You want to love Jesus? Seriously? Love the one who looks the least like him. That was really good. And we started off, man, really good. This thing has, it's like a cat. It does whatever it wants to, whenever it wants to. In AD 70, after the church is just rocking the pagans, AD 70, the Jewish temple was destroyed. And I don't know, I just kind of like it was like kind of like God going, bonk. Hey, listen, I told you I want the temple destroyed, that temple model destroyed. And I think we'll just do it. In AD 70, that happened. And I had a dream the other night. I told Lisa about it, where I was standing in front of the temple. Probably because this has been on my mind a lot, or it could have been the pizza I ate, but I'm one of those two things. But he stood at the temple. He grabbed the temple curtain. It was very thick. And he ripped it right in two. And I started to move towards it. I was like, I'm going in. Yay! I mean, I've heard it my whole life. Hey, he tore it in two so we could all enter in. Praise God! Woo! By his gates we will enter. Or by his praise we'll enter his gates. Praise for whatever. Anyways. That's a stupid song. Anyways, it was a good song back in the day. It just kind of lost its anointing now. But anyways, what he said to me was, he goes, I didn't tear it in two for you to come in to the temple. I tore it in two so I could come out. And I don't know, because here's the thing, you know, we saw, we sing it every Christmas, you know, Emmanuel, God with us. Do you understand that God not only is with us, but he now resides in us. That's crazy. Crazy, crazy that he would look at your life, he'd look at my life, and he'd go, I want to come live with you. But don't you understand? I've made these mistakes. Yeah. I want to come live with you. And God has decided to do this. He's decided to clean us from the inside out rather than the outside in. And if we could start doing that with people, allowing God to do the cleaning and we do the loving, I think the world would be a whole lot better place. Holy Spirit does a great job of convicting people. You don't. We have mastered condemning people, finding what's wrong with people, but we're not really that good at convicting people, but Holy Spirit is brilliant at it. And if we would do our job, our assignment, to love God and love them, then the Holy Spirit can do his assignment of convicting people and raising people and teaching people and counseling people and guiding people and bringing comfort to people. He does a great job of that. And we co-labor with him. We see his kingdom come, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This is my favorite date in history, almost. I was born on 10/29/1962. This happened on 10/28/312. It was a little bit earlier. By a day. But the Emperor Constantine was after the Emperor Maximus. Why did they call their kid? Just call him Max. Isn't that much easier? Khan and Max. So Khan is taking on Max. They're both co-emperors. And Constantine, on his way to battle Max. That sounds like a game, too. Battle Max. EA Sports. It's in the game. The kid with the headphones on got that right here in the front. So Constantine is on his way to battle Max, and on his way, he has a vision. And in his vision, he sees a cross beyond the sun. And then he hears a voice say to him, this statement, in this sign, conquer. So what Constantine does is he puts the sign of the cross, which was the sign of crucifixion, on shields, and and on what they were wearing and stuff. And they went and they beat the snot out of Max, and he became the emperor of what we've known as. See, this is the picture, and this is him, and he bought these clothes at the mall and that kind of stuff. I think the kind of, Levi, you'd look good in that. I think that would look, that's a nice. But they called it what would be known in like the 12th century as the Holy Roman Empire. The problem with the Holy Roman Empire was they were much more Roman and much more empire than they were holy. But Constantine, watch this, he took Christianity from being a persecuted minority group of people to being an empowered majority group of people by doing this. Constantine said, listen, I'm going to start building and investing in the church. I'm all in. I'm bought in. I'm going to pour my life, money in, everything I have access to, all my resources. I'm going to pour into the church. And he began to fund the Pope, and he began to fund the bishops, and he began to fund and build all these churches, all these temples. Every place there was a martyr, he'd build a new church. And all of a sudden, it became popular to be a Christian because there were benefits to being a Christian. So all the rich people started becoming Christians because if they took their money and they dedicated it to the church or their lands and they dedicated the church, it became tax exempt. And so all of a sudden, all of this stuff is happening and money's being given. And Constantine did some great things. Money was given to people for taking care of orphans and widows and single moms. And he's doing all the right things. And maybe even to begin with, for the right reasons. But watch this, and I'm doing this on purpose. I'm talking about history on purpose because I think we can learn from history that we don't repeat history. And what happened was there was this thing, if you've read it in school, maybe they took it out by now, it was called the Arian controversy, and it was over the word begotten. And Arius and it was said this. He said, he goes, that Jesus was born divine. Everybody, that's good. That's nothing, right? I mean, you know, but there was another group of people that said, no, he grew into his divinity. You know, and I know all of you have had these conversations around dinner table, just probably this week. But this was a big deal back in the day. And literally, watch this. The church was divided over a theology. To the point where Constantine called this big party together, this big meeting together, we've got to make sure that we don't lose unity. So in order to make sure that everyone stayed unified, Constantine wrote this edict. He said this, and I hereby make a public order that if someone should be discovered to have hidden a writing composed by Arius and not to have immediately brought it forward and destroyed it by fire, his penalty shall be death. And all of a sudden, we have Christians killing Christians. And the reason we had Christians killing Christians was because we didn't believe the same thing. Or we didn't believe the same way. And all of a sudden, somehow, something got shifted in us that as long as you believed correctly, you could behave any way that you wanted to. And all of a sudden, and then they started to put out all of these creeds. You know, I believe in God the Father, and I believe in this, I believe. And all of a sudden, as long as you believe the right way, then your sins were forgiven. You could have that thing taken care of, and you could behave any way you want, and you were still okay. As long as you believed the right way, it didn't matter how you behaved. And in all the creeds, you know that love was never mentioned once in all the creeds that were written during this time period? Do you know that in this time period, there was never even any conversation about behaviors? It only mattered. In fact, if you would come and say you believed a certain way, and there's a reason they did this, because the emperors had to sign off on the creeds that were written during that day, and the reason that they had, and so what they did was they would write the creeds, the emperors would sign off, but the emperor wouldn't sign off on it if the emperor wasn't living up to the creed that was written, so they would write the creed in order to pacify the emperor who would sign off with it to put the creed into place, and because the emperor actually owned the church. They didn't want to lose the bucks. That makes sense? All of a sudden, the Pope and the bishops, and listen, I'm not against Catholics, I'm not against Protestants, I'm not against people. But the reality is the reality. All of a sudden, when all of a sudden this power started to come, and this money started to come, it started to, if you would, make toxic the purity of what was the gospel that Jesus had to start with. And all these creeds went out, and all of a sudden, these popes and these people, these sacred men became the gatekeepers of heaven and hell, and they would tell you whether you were going to go to heaven or they would tell you whether you were going to hell. Based upon, they would withhold baptism from you. They would withhold communion from you. They would hold you hostage and in bondage, and what they did was they took the scriptures and they bound them at the altar of the church, and they said, listen, we're not going to let anybody read these things. We'll interpret them the way that benefits us the best, and then we're going to make everybody act. And they created such a fear based upon whether you're going to heaven or hell, to such a point where they said, listen, they called all these men in, they said, listen, we're going to forgive all your sins. Now we want you to go and take back the Holy Land. Oh, and on your way, do whatever you want. You can rape and pillage people. Now, they didn't say this, but this is what happened. You can rape and pillage people. You can go into that city. You kill whoever you need to kill on the way to there. You do whatever you want to do. Why? Because your sins are forgiven. Why? Because you believe a certain way. It doesn't matter how you behave. I'd like to propose to you that you don't actually believe anything unless you behave that way. You can say you believe this way, but if you behave this way, you don't believe that at all. Does that make sense? But now we have all this going on, the justification. If you believe a certain way, you can act any way that you want to. And they went into the Holy Land, and they took the Holy Land, and because the Pope said, it is God's will that we go in there and we massacre these people. He said this, and they went in, and it must have been God's will because they did massacre those people, and they did get the Holy Land. You know, I'm just playing here, but they only had it for 100 years, and then Saladin took it back 100 years later. So it must be God's will changed, that the Crusaders never would have the Holy Land ever again. But in the process of taking the Holy Land, ready for this, they went in there and they decided that we're going to kill the people who killed Jesus. And they began to massacre all the Jews, men, women, and children. It didn't matter. In the name of God, can I tell you, listen to me, this it. Now, can I just say, here's the thing that we went wrong. A whole bunch of people got the sacred text, a whole bunch of uneducated people, untrained, unmentored, undiscipled, a whole bunch of people got this sacred text, and they all started getting their own interpretations of what the text meant, and they didn't have the thing that was motivating the reading of the text, which Jesus had intended to say, that it's, listen, it was by love, not the fact of how much text you know. And what happened was, and Martin Luther said it right, that the simple layman was armed. Jesus never meant his word to be weapons against his people. And now the Pope wasn't the one inflicting pain on people. The bishops weren't the one inflicting pain on people. People's interpretation of scripture started to inflict pain on people. And for hundreds and hundreds of years, the Protestant church, the evangelicals, pastors, I'm all a part of that, y'all, but we've been beating people up with scripture. We've been finding every way to call out things wrong in people's lives and tell them what they're doing wrong. It was never intended to be that way. This is sacred scripture given to us, God's love letters to us, never intended to be a weapon against your brother or against your sister. And that's what started with Martin Luther. For good reasons, man, we needed reformation. But we lost something very valuable called love. Here's the good news. It's back. What the enemy meant for destruction. See, the enemy will always take good stuff and God's stuff and turn it into bad stuff. And that's how it decays. We take it from God's stuff to good stuff to bad stuff. And all God's stuff in the wrong hands can be bad stuff. Faith is a God thing, but without love, it's dangerous. This next part of my message as I close. I don't think it happened. So just fantasize with me for a minute, because it could have. Got Jesus, Paul, and Peter standing in heaven looking off their deck. They got a barbecue going on in the background. Stay with me. It's the aroma, you know. And Jesus looks down. He's going, Paul, Peter, what happened? What is going on? Listen, I was with them. The very last thing I did with them was I was with them and I'm talking to them and I washed their stinking feet. They probably did stink, right? I washed their stinking feet. And I told them, I said to them, no, see, this is how you love one another. This is what I want you to do. This is what I want it to be all about. I want you to get down. I don't want you to argue and bicker over what people believe, this person believes. I don't want you killing each other and having all these denominations and divisions and separations and divorces and this things breaking apart because of lack of agreement. I want, just get down and wash their each other's feet. Just love one to love one. Love what he said this. Oh, he says, as I've loved you, so I want you to love one another. And guys, guess what? By this, everyone will know that you're my disciples. That if you love one another, they're going to know. Well, yeah, but what about scripture? Reverend? I know. And what about the 66? Well, I know, but yeah, what? It's how you love. Do you love well? Are you washing their feet? Are you being the servant of all? Do you have time? Do you make time? Then Paul said, yeah, but Jesus, you know, I get, you know, great. I love what you said to him. But he goes, I wrote it down. And I put it in letter form. And I sent it out to them all. And I told them, listen, guys, this is Paul in agreement with Jesus. It's always a good thing. The only thing that counts, say that with me, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. Jesus said, listen, he goes, you come to the temple. He goes, that's good because you come to the temple because you got something you want to make right with God. And you recognize that you got something wrong with your brother. God says, stop. Don't worry about making things right with me first. I want you to go and make things right with your brother before you come and make things right with me. Why? Because God's more concerned about how we're getting along, man, than he is. Listen, you're good. You're good with God. Let me show you why in just a minute. Peter, last guy up there, you know, Peter's got to have something to say too. And Peter goes, you know, Jesus, Paul, I get it. Jesus, you got a garden tomb. But you know what? You know what they did on my tomb? They built a temple. The very thing we didn't want them to do, they built a temple on top of my tomb. What is wrong? I told him, I said to him, I kept talking to him, listen, have sincere love, y'all. Have sincere love for who? Not just God. Because if you have sincere love for God, you're going to have sincere love for each other. Love one another how? How? Shallow love, surface love? How do we love one another? Deeply. From where? From our core. From our very core. And I think what the problem is, still today, there's a little bit of temple still left in all of us. If you don't think so, ask yourself this question. Have you ever wondered how close you could get to sin without actually sinning? See, that's temple model thinking. What exactly do I have to do to please God? What exactly can I get away with? How close can I get? Listen, if you're more concerned about getting close with something that's antichrist than Christ, then it's temple model thinking that you just, I don't want to make God mad, but I also want to get as close to living in sin as I can. That's temple model thinking. What bothers you more? Not reading your Bible or mistreating someone? See, for me, it used to be, well, I'm more concerned about getting into the Word than the fact that I hurt one of my kids. Than the fact that I said something bad or thought something bad about maybe one of you. See, it bothered me more that I didn't have my God time instead of me worrying about how's our relationship here. And my Father's been telling me, I want you to have great relationships here because I want my kingdom to come here. My kingdom's not coming if these relationships aren't settled, because they're going to know that you are mine by how you love each other. There's been a whole lot of people that have made God look really bad by saying, I love God and I can't stand you. And I'm sorry for that. I'm sorry I've done that. I'm sorry anybody who's represented God has done that to you, because I'm concerned there are a lot of people that have a problem with him because of how we've acted. Have you ever feared for the destiny of your child because somebody told them they were going to hell because they weren't baptized as a kid? That's temple model thinking. Have you ever failed morally with someone? What bothers you more, how it affects you or how it affects them? If you've engaged with sin, no matter what it is, if it's been adultery or fornication or gossip or whatever it is, are you more concerned about how it affected you, or are you more concerned about how it affected them? Because temple model people are always more concerned about how they are with God rather than how they are with other people. I promise you that if you have this right with God, your first concern is going to be how you treat other people. That will be a direct indicator in integrity how you treat other people. Do you believe that there is some ritual that makes you right with God and removes your responsibility to people that you hurt? Well, I said my 40 Hail Marys, or I went to the altar and I prayed and I had a pastor prophesy over me. Whatever it is there a ritual that says, oh, you're okay, but yet you still have aught with your brother? Go to your brother. Go to your sister. And if you think they got a problem with you, go to them. Get the air cleared. Get clean air, guys. In your marriage, in your relationships, with your kids, clean the air. Love them unconditionally, because love is not going to fail. It doesn't have the capacity to fail. Do other people's sins elicit feelings of superiority in you? That's temple model. Oh, I'm glad I pray. I'm glad I give my money. I'm glad I do this. I'm glad I go to church. I'm glad I'm not like them. That's temple model. Jesus was willing to die for them. He laid down his life for them. He had nothing that felt superior to them. He was a servant of all. That was his mindset. Do your beliefs, do your theology ever get in the way of your love or your relationship with somebody else? Have you stopped relationships because you'd rather be right rather than be in relationship? Maybe the relationship's more important than you being right. Temple model thinking says, I can't relate with you. I can't have a relationship with you. I can't walk with you because I don't believe like you. Can I just tell you something? The best way that you make an enemy a friend is by love. This is really good. If you don't start cheering me on, I'm not going to let you out of here. All right. How many believe Jesus died for you? Yeah? If somebody dies for you, you've got to know this. He is for you. And if you can settle this today, he's not concerned about you constantly getting back. Oh, God, I got to make it right with you. God, are you okay with me? Am I okay with you? Are you okay with me? He died for you. He is for you. He is for you. He adores you. There's nothing that can separate you from the love of God. Now walk in your identity. Walk in your purpose. Walk in your destiny. Reveal the heart of your Father to everyone around you by how you love, not by how you argue. That's just the truth. What happens to the world? What happens to your world? What happens to your life? What happens to your family? God's love for us and for those around us, when that begins to inform our conscience and shapes our behaviors, it's going to be a great day when love is the motivator of how we think about Him, us, and them, and then how we behave is in alignment with who we are. That is going to change the whole world. The way that it began is the way it's supposed to end. Love will find its way. I promise you that. Stand with me this morning. Stacy, will you come and just pray and declare over these amazing people the amazing love, kindness, the freedom that is in Christ Jesus. Bless you guys. Hope to see you tonight. In Jesus' name.
Father, we just thank you that you love us so deeply. And Lord, as we leave this place, Lord, let that word just go deep into our hearts, that we will love the person next to us, that we will love the person in the restaurant, that we will see people differently the way that you see them. Help us to not judge by what our eyes see or our ears hear, but to just love them the way you love them. And Father, we ask, God, that we just pray, God, that we would become your representatives. We would be Christians, little Christ ones, little anointed ones, God, that actually live like you would have lived and love like you would have loved the ones that we meet this week. And I pray, God, that all of Horseheads would be transformed as your body just lives like you live and loves like you love and serves like you serve and washes the feet of people around us this week. So God, we bless this people. We bless this congregation. We bless them to experience your love, to encounter your love, and to be catalysts of your love wherever they go. In Jesus' name, amen.
All that is now yours.